Chris made it for BBTV. He likes to say I'm joined by former five-time world champion, Jane Couch MBE. Do you know what, Jane? It's great to see you today. We've been meaning to do this for ages.
Yeah, we've been trying to catch up for ages, haven't we, Chris? Yeah. And listen, I just want to say it's an honour for me to be doing this because you were one of the first on the scene. I remember when we first started, we used to ring you up and try and get a bit of advice of how to get stuff out, and you was brilliant. You always helped with the iFilm London lot. You're a top man and you're proper real.
Appreciate that, Jane. You're in Manchester. You used to spend a lot of time here, the Fleetwood Assassin. What are you doing in Manchester?
I'm in Manchester. Well, I was in Fleetwood yesterday doing my book signing. Book was released yesterday, the final round, and I'm with Ricky, my old mate Ricky, today, and Stacey's here, so just come down to see everyone and get rid of a few books, and it's brilliant, and it's just so good being up north. It's just heaven.
Well, of course, you live in Bristol. That's where you pretty much had to get your career off the ground, in Bristol, wasn't it?
Yeah, the only reason I went to Bristol, to be honest with you, Chris, I would have stayed here, but like in them days, it was just unheard of. And my amateur trainer in Fleetwood was training at an amateur club in Fleetwood, and they didn't like the fact that he was training a woman, so we sort of pretty much got ran out of Fleetwood gym. And I was offered a chance to go to Bristol, and I had to take it because I tried a few gyms in around, even around Manchester. I remember going to Brian Hughes's gym. You know, Brian, he was older then, and women in boxing, it just didn't sit right with them, and you know, they were a bit not too keen on it, and I just didn't want to. I didn't want to leave the Northwest. I was born and bred in Fleetwood, but just one of them things took me on another journey, I suppose. But it's very different, the Bristol people to the Manchester people, and the people up north. I just love it up here. I just love it, and it's just great to be back, and it's great to be in Ricky's gym.
You got to see your family in Fleetwood.
I did a book signing, first book signing, because release date was yesterday. So we did the first book signing at the library, and so many young girls. Oh, it was brilliant, like 6-year-olds, 7-year-olds. And just to see them, like, have that confidence, going, yeah, I'm a boxer, like, because obviously it was a bit cloak and dagger when I first started. You were sort of putting a punch bag under the stairs and hoping nobody saw you. But to see that yesterday, and even Stacey here today, I mean, Stacey Copeland is just a brilliant, brilliant ambassador for women. Brilliant. Love her to bits.
I'm really looking forward to reading a book, Jane. I read an old book. You did one before, didn't
you? Yeah, The Fleetwood Assassin. I didn't have a lot to do with it, to be honest, Chris.
It was more of a...
Yeah, it was more somebody else is writing it. And I was just agreeing to stuff that I shouldn't really agree to. But, like, I retired, I had a bit of a breakdown. See Ricky go through a breakdown, see Tyson, Frank Bruno, all good friends of mine. And I thought, you know what? I'm better now. It's time to write the book and tell people how women's boxing really got started.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You really had your struggles at the beginning. You're a pioneer for women's boxing, the first lady.
I know.
Of, as Bobby Rimmer was saying,
I love Bobby Rimmer. I love Bobby. Bobby, I love you.
The first lady of UK boxing. You did have it hard, Jane, and people will read all this in the book, but you know, initially just trying to get your professional license from the boxing board, you know, they just refused you on all types of ridiculous grounds. But you took them to court and you won and you got your license.
Yeah.
You know, take us back to that sort of that time, and you know, just how hard. I mean, look at female boxing now, and
yeah,
we've got a long way to go, but it's come a long way since.
It's come easy, yeah. Yeah. Ricky's giving me shit here in the background, and killing. He's trying to ruin the interview, that Ricky. I'm going to knock him out in a minute. But yeah, God, it was massive. It's massively different now to what it was then, because like in them days, if you was classed as a lesbian or a freak or a weirdo or all these horrible things, and then you look at it now and you're seeing these kids and Stacey and everything's really accepted, but there is still a long way to go, you know. And I think another reason while I'm doing all these interviews, I'm just going to say it how it is, because like people like Stacey, it all goes on ticket sales and stuff, so it's all down to money. And she's not Ricky Hatton, she can't sell 18,000 in MEN. I think the most I ever saw was 2,000 tickets in Bristol, you know. And that to a mailboxer, it doesn't add up, the figures don't add up. So there's a massive, still a massively long way to go. But hopefully with people like Stacey and, you know, the good boxers coming through, then things will change. But in the 90s, it was just horrendous. And I actually think, like now I've retired and sort of gone through a bit of the breakdown and it was just reflecting on everything. And I think I just retired and just sort of went, I can just finally just be normal and just tell the truth and not have to be like seen as this freak or this monster or this person that the media made you out to be, that you won't really like that, but you sort of went along with it because in them days I'd do anything to get a fight. I think, you know, I'd say anything or I'd do anything because I didn't have a choice. I just wanted to fight, and it was the only way, really.
You like played a character.
Yeah, I sort of played a game with them. I sort of played their game. So that it was like, it stemmed from the Barrymore thing. So the Barrymore thing was just one big setup. It was like, oh, he'd kick you, and then you hit him back, and you've always got to be in your boxing gear. Then it went
on. This was Michael Barrymore show,
when he was like big in the 90s. He kicked me. And then I hit him, and then they made all this big thing out of it. And it was like it meant to be a jokey interview, which it was. But then the press made a lot more out of it. And I think from then I thought, well, maybe that's what people want to see. That's what people assume that women boxers are like. And because I was so uneducated, I didn't do school. I was just a little rebel child and never had any real aspirations. But then when I did, and Barrymore was big at the time, it was like 15 million viewers on fucking ITV, and it was massive. There was only three channels in them days. So I just thought,
but overnight it was like
overnight, it was an overnight sensation, and it was mad. And I just thought, oh well, that's what people want. And I just carried on doing it. Whereas if I was more educated, we're like Stacey now. Stacey can just speak brilliant because she's seen it all. She's seen everything before, and she's seen probably me making a fool of myself, and you know, me going through bad times. But people like her now are just, they're just much more media savvy than I ever was, do you know? And then in them days, again, Stacey will tell you, even now with a northern accent, they go, oh, you got a northern accent, so can't put you on BBC. Well, so that's all rubbish, you know. Northerners are like the best people in the world, aren't they, I think? And I think the accent's fantastic. And why should you change your accent? Just boxing's just different. There was no Twitter, there was no Facebook, there was none of this video stuff, none of that. So now, people can just do what they want, really, can't they? We can make our, me and you could make a video and put some out there, and it'd probably go massive on just a load of shit.
Yeah. Not like it used to be newspapers, and now you can put your own message out there.
You can put your own message out there, yeah. It's true. And well, we never had that opportunity to do that. I mean, you've been in this game a long time, Chris, so you know, you must have seen even the video world like changing. But the British boxing, I think, is probably one of the best ones. It's right up there. It's right up there. People like Bobby Rimmer on it, like, what do you expect?
Try to do it for the right reasons, Jamie.
Yeah, and that's the difference. You do it for the right reasons, and you do it from the heart. And me and my boxing, because I had to do anything I could to get a fight, and when I got the fight, I did it from the heart. It was never about money, never made any money. It cost me to fight a lot of the time. Like I said, you get to a show and you didn't even have a room or things like that, but it's not like one of them, oh, this, what a shame, poor old Jane Couch, because it isn't. I had a great time. I went round the world, I met some of the biggest names in the world, and do you know what made it even better? That I had nothing, and I was relying on them to help me and get me through. Remember Lennox Lewis holding a torch for Tex when he was wrapping my hands in a dressing room in Jamaica, and he was visiting his mum, and he came to the show, and all the electric went off on the beach in Montego Bay, and Tex is wrapping hands, and Lennox Lewis stood there in the dressing room holding the torch so we could see to put the bandages on the ring. But do you know what? All them things make good stories, and it helped me help the other women, because Stacey's And the other girls now have still got to move this sport forward because it's not where it should be yet. And the pay gap's still going to ever be like that. Never, ever. I don't think you'll ever see a female Ricky Hatton selling out the MEM for 18,000 people. Maybe you will, but not while we're alive. Not while we're alive. It's run by men. It's run by men, and it always will be. And as much as Frank Warren and Frank Malone, oh, yeah, we've changed, they haven't changed. They've been told to change. They've been told, oh, yeah, have a BT Sport deal, but you've got to have a woman on it. Listen, they can't film me. I know full well how they feel. Full well how they feel. And do you know the other thing? You do the promo for the book, and I put it out on Twitter. I did this as a bet with someone. I won't say who I done the bet with. I said, I bet you any money, Frank Warren, Maloney, all the big boys, all the big video companies that are just above everybody. I bet none of them retweet it. And guess what? I was right. And guess what? It didn't affect the pre-sales one bit.
I mean, female boxing was hard to be accepted by the public in general. British Boxing Board of Control weren't accepted, but the people in boxing as well, did they find it hard to accept? The actual boxers as well, trainers.
It was everyone in the 90s. It was
up against everyone, Jane.
It was the trainers, the boxers, the media, the boxing board. They were brutal. They were just absolutely brutal. And they said it to my face. They said it to my face, Jane. Fuck off, we don't want you about. You're a lesbian, you're a weirdo, you're a horrible cunt. Said it to your face. I didn't care because I give it them back as well. But do you know what? In the end, I think it did affect me towards the end. I think, yeah, all them things did get to me because I am not, anyone that knows me, like I do wear my heart on my sleeve and I do say what I think, but I just think, again, we never had Facebook and social media and all these videos. I cringe now when I look at interviews that I did and I'm thinking, what was I thinking? But again, I went through the mental health thing. I wasn't myself, do you know what I mean? But look, we've moved on now, and people like Stacey need us, need our backing, Ricky's backing. And I think the only people in boxing that really helped me was Ricky and Paul in the beginning, because everybody hated me. Terry Dooley, brilliant. People like him, the real old-school journalists that really know the stuff, they're not checking the records on Boxrec, or I'll just do an interview with this boxer, just let me check his interview, let me check his record on Boxrec. You wouldn't have to check a boxer's record on Boxrec. I wouldn't have to, because we're real boxing people. But see, now all these outsiders are coming in, and they've just pushed that story aside. Right, let's forget Jane Couch existed, let's forget the two lawyers that fought, and the case cost hundreds of thousands of pounds, and if I'd have lost, I would have had to pay it. Do you know, let's forget all that, let's just move on and pretend that we've always liked women's boxing. It's bullshit. And everybody knows people like Bobby Rimmer, Ricky Hatton, Terry Dooley, they know the truth, because they're all real boxing people. So look, everybody else is coming out and doing it, so I'm just going to come out and tell the truth. Be a few people running for cover the next few weeks.
I mean, you have had your ups and downs, Jane, but let's not forget you was a 5-time world champion. Yeah. And there must have been some great times as well. I mean, there's times you went over to Las Vegas and had to sleep on the floor in the casino. But,
I know.
You know, these things made you a fighter.
Yeah, but things like that make you, because, but also what I find is, and this is where boxing falls down, once you retire, there's nothing there, and you go down and you get downer and downer and downer. So unless you can pick yourself up off that and think a different way and play the game that they're playing, because it's all a game. The boxing business, it's a business. That's all it is. You've got to play the game. They don't give a fuck when Ricky Hatton retires and when I retire. They don't give a fuck. They just want to film videos of him having a good time with his family in Tenerife. But that's not Ricky. Ricky's a great person. You know, the real people in boxing know the truth. And I just think it's great now we're allowed to say it. And we can do stuff like this.
When you look at them world title defences and it was in America, after you won it in the first one was in Germany, I believe. Was it
Denmark was the first Denmark, one. Yeah. New Orleans was the second one. Mm. Atlantic City was the third. Too many to remember.
Do you know
I remember. Matthews. I remember spending the week with Matthew Sal Mohammed, and to me he was an absolute legend, you know, at the time. A lot of people now wouldn't even remember him, but fought John Conte, but real legend. I remember spending a week with him in New Orleans before my fight, and it was only at the end of the week he told me he was homeless and that he couldn't get a ticket to go and watch me fight, and I'm like, wow, like, there's me looking at this legend. I got him in the fight, don't worry about that, and I got him somewhere to live, and I got him tickets for the fight. But that taught me a lesson, that, because I was looking at him and putting him on this pedestal thinking, but he didn't tell me, he never told me that the problems, and I think that's the problems with boxers, is like, when they're struggling and they need help, they don't tell anyone because of this match, it's a macho sport, so they don't open up. And you just carry on and carry on. And then all of a sudden you lit that brick wall and it's very hard to get back up. Listen, I've been there and it's hard. And if it weren't for Ricky and Frank and Tyson coming out and speaking about it, I might not be here myself, do you know what I mean? Or I might be here sleeping homeless like a lot of the other boxers are doing, like a lot of the ex-fighters being in prison. You just don't know, do you?
So after the height, it's a big fall.
After the high, and I had some highs, man. I boxed on the same bill as Lennox Lewis, Prince Naseem Hamed in New York.
Roy Jones
Jr. Oh, we had just...
Mike Tyson?
No, it wasn't. That was DJ Gogarty, but like, I brought Tyson to Bristol and spent a few good times with him. But like, some of the fighters that I met and that I mixed with, and big names, mind. And yeah, all you are is a warm-up fight, but for me, it meant the world. Yeah, RJ, we'll give you 200 quid, just warm up the audience. But I didn't care. I'd have done it for free. It did cost me to fight, but at the end of the day, everything happens for a reason, doesn't it, I think? And I think now I'm thinking more clear, and now I'm like, better in myself. I think that I appreciate it more now than I did then. I look back.
When you got to America, because here it was like you've already told, but when you got to America, did you find women's boxing over there that was a little bit more advanced? We had Christy Martin.
Well, yeah, but in them days, you've got to remember, it was more advanced, because to be fair, it was just a bit after Christy Martin, but she'd already made the platform on all the Mike Tyson things. But then you had Lucy Riker, Sumi Inani. Lucy Riker was better than some men. Better than men. She used to beat up men. He trained her, wasn't he? Manny Stewart was training her. And she was beating up Rose Ellis and all the Mexicans in the gym. I mean, I had no idea. I got thrown to the lions. I got 12 days notice to fight the greatest woman fighter on planet Earth.
Near the end of your career.
And listen, I don't think you'll get a better fighter than Lucy Riker. Best one ever, yeah. Ever.
What was it like being in there with her compared to everyone? Wow. The other world
never been at Swan. And listen, I used to spar with men because there was no women. So I was sparring with good standard pros, British level, world level, area level, even just starting out. But to spar against men was hard, you know, and in them days as well, they didn't want to be getting hit by a woman, so they had more to prove. But I have never been hit so hard as by her. Eardrum burst in the first round, and I thought, I just didn't know what was going on because I never had a burst. I thought it was brain damage or something. I still carried on, still done the 8 rounds with her, and it was a cracking little fight. But Sky commentary and all the newspapers, it was all negative because they was like, oh, she's not going to last 2 rounds, and this, that, and the other, and you're like, no, instead of praising the fact that you've even got to the Staples Centre to box on the same bill as Lennox Lewis, Vitali Klitschko, it was just, everything was negative then, negative, 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 and then that plays a part on you. I mean, after that fight, I should have retired, to be honest. I should have retired, but I never carried on because, again, you're not educated, so you don't know what to do. Oh, I'll have one more fight, and then that might be the big one. I might get the big payday. Never comes. You've just got to see it for what it is.
Yeah. And you know, when the time to retire did come, I mean, you had did you fail a brain scan near the end?
Yeah, I failed.
I heard you say in the past you feel you retired later than you should have done.
Yeah, I think I should have retired after Riker. I took a lot of punishment in the fight. A lot of hard shots, like I said, perforated eardrum, 3 broken ribs, broken nose, broken jaw. You know, I wasn't in the best way. Even though the fight was pretty competitive. You know, it was. I still took a lot of damage, and the sparring was Catley and Dorrington and Clayfield. It was catching up with me. You know, it was real catching up with me, and he was having wars in the gym with like Bristol amateurs, and Bristol, they was at the top of their amateur game. I was having wars with these lads. So yeah, I should have retired sooner, but again, what was I going to do? I had no education. I had no money. I was living on the training camp, so that was my life as well. I wasn't just training at the training camp; I was actually living on the farm. So then I thought,
I'm working on the farm.
Just living there and eating. Oh, I don't know. It was just weird, and I just wish I could have seen boxing for what it was sooner than I did, and I didn't. And by that, it sort of damages your. The way you look at things and people and other boxers and managers and promoters, I just look at them different now. And maybe if I'd have retired sooner, maybe I wouldn't have done. Down to, I've got to take a bit of the responsibility as well. I'm the fighter, you know, I should have realised it was time to go. But and the other thing is, it didn't seem like it was still getting anywhere, because even after I got the licence, Maloney and Warren were still freezing me out. They were still like, oh no, we're not promoting her. And still like doing everything possible to make it as difficult and as horrible and as vile as they could for me. And then I thought, I know what it is now. It's personal, because it wasn't, they hated women's boxing that much. They took it personal on me. They did it, do you know, they just did. And it was vile what they did to me. It was just horrible. And it made me feel, I just can't explain the way that it made me feel. And I thought all these people were my friends. Don't worry, I know my friends are in boxing now, and you can count them on one hand, but boxing's a weird one, because it's still a great sport, but the business side of it and the horrible side of it is just, there's nothing like it, is it?
I mean, you might say you was born too early, but you know, female boxing needed Jane Couch at that time.
God, I wish there was a Jane Couch before me, believe me, because I tell you, that done a lot of damage. It was that was one fight that really took it out of me. That in all the fights and all the sparring I had in the ring, that abuse, that just nastiness, not just to me, to the women lawyers as well that defended me, and the press and. Oh, people like Ian Gibb from the Daily Mail. It was just vile. And when your mum and your friends and your family that don't really understand and are reading stuff like this about you, you know, and everyone was writing bad stuff, oh, she's this, she's that, she's effing and blinding here. I didn't know any different. But look, I'm 51 now. I've had a great learning curve, and it's just, thank God, I've come out the other side, innit? And I recognise, but I always recognised the good people. As I was going through boxing, I always knew the good ones, always did. I don't know why I've just got that affinity to recognise them, but the others, do you know what? Is what it is, innit? But at least I learned a lesson.
Yeah. I mean, when you did retire, it was a bit of a struggle for you, was it? You know, you touched on it there, that you did suffer from mental health problems. And that get up and go, you know, you didn't always have it.
Yeah,
you know,
I just
gave
up.
Days were long, and, you know, what do you do after boxing? And, take us back to that time, and
that's
know,
just
where
our,
did you go and how did you get through that?
That's just hard for any boxer. And I don't think any boxers that's boxing now, they won't realise until it comes, but all of a sudden, everything changes, and just suddenly, overnight, it just goes down, your phone stops ringing, people don't want to talk to you anymore. And maybe it isn't that, maybe it's just because you're not fighting anymore. You're no longer a use to anyone, you can't make anyone any money anymore. So, jog on. So if you haven't got something backed up for when you retire, you're really going to struggle. And believe me, I know boxers that are in prison, that are homeless, and that have done some great things in the ring. I mean, even our Harold Graham, one of our best ever, you know, fighters. And
do you see Harold? How is he?
I spoke to him just on the phone and on text, but he's, you know, he needs our help. he does need help.
How can we do that?
I don't know. I think maybe we need to get together and maybe speak to him. And the last thing, he was away in some home in London. I think a few of the London boys are trying to help him, like Kevin Mitchell and that. So I think we just need to get the message out there, not just for Harold, for a lot of the lads that are struggling, and maybe, I don't know. I mean, we're doing the Thrones now for the mental health, so maybe some of that money could go to help them. I don't know. Maybe this ringside rest and care. I mean, that looks a fantastic thing, doesn't it?
It does.
And I think they are helping Harold as well. So, listen, there's got to be something that we can all do. And just a shame the big promoters and the boxing board sort of turn the back, don't they, then? So if they was getting some out of it, they wouldn't. But listen, they've had the money's worth out of Errol.
Hey everyone, Ricky the Hitman Hatton here. I've just signed the throne there for the Frank Bruno Foundation. Going to be trying to auction these off and raise some money, you know, to raise money for Frank's foundation. So if you can dig deep, work hard, it's going to a very, very worthy cause, and a cause that, you know, the more help it needs, the better it's going to be, because mental health is so, so serious these days, and it's everywhere you see. So the more money we can help, the more people we're going to save.
The boxing, Jane, you got into promoting, didn't you, and managing, and you had another battle because you got your manager's license took off you at one point. I don't know if you want to, you know, go into that, but you know, after boxing, you did a few different things. You did the videoing. You was working with Steve Wood on the VIP doing that. You did a bit for iFilm London doing the videos.
Yeah.
And then you disappeared from boxing.
Yeah, I think doing the videos actually made me realise what a fucking bunch of scumbags in boxing, because I was seeing things in the dressing rooms that I didn't want to see. Now, people that haven't boxed and haven't been a professional boxer and they're filming, they're not seeing what I'm seeing. I'm seeing an emotional wreck and people crying after a fight and in front of the families and getting stitched up, and not me knowing that's it for them. That's it. They're fucked. But people that haven't got that experience in boxing, and they don't care about them boxers. I'm another fighter, cared about every fighter that I interviewed, and it just tortured me, and I just went to a real dark place, and I thought, I've got to get out of it, and I was ill then, you know. I'd just been diagnosed with the ADHD and very bad hyperactivity. I'm a lot better than I was, but I was just getting diagnosed with it as I was going through that. And as I was seeing, like, these ticket sellers getting beat and these promoters arguing with that manager and that manager slagging that one off and that one, I just thought, wow. Like, I give up 18 years for this. For what? For what? For someone just to, like, don't give a fuck about you. I thought, no, that's not right. And to be fair, the video probably did open my eyes more than the boxing, because you see things that, like, it's so false, it's so fake in boxing, because he'll talk to him and then he'll go and talk to someone else and then he'll slag him out, and I'll be like, oh, that Chris from British Boxing, he's great, and then I'll go over to him and say, oh, he's a fucking wanker. Like, I wouldn't do that, but that's the boxing world, isn't it? That's how it works these days. And well, in them days it definitely did. But I just think there's such a nice lot of people in there, and it's always the good ones that get shit on, you know? And that's what I was seeing. I was on Steve Wood's small low shows and just seeing things that weren't very nice. And even on the undercard fighters on the big bills, like I used to be, I was only a warm-up fighter for Lennox Lewis, Roy Jones. I knew that, I understood that. But if you could hear what they were saying, it's a different ball game. And look, there's probably 3% of boxers that will make out of it. You know, they've got to be like Lennox Lewis in it to make anything. But the rest of us, it's not there for long. It's just get in and get out and keep your sanity and have something else in place, because there's a lot of horrible ones out there. You get the nice ones, you'll get the Bobby Rimmers and the Terry Dooleys of the world, and, you know, yourself, you're a good lad, but... You're just gonna get the the bad as well, and the bad outweighs the good in this game, and it's just sad. It's just sad.
When you did finally walk away from boxing, it wasn't, you know, a thing that was in your life and on your mind all the time. What did you do, Jane? And you know, what have you been doing for the last few years since you've...
Well, yeah, I mean, like I said, I went, I got the medication, I started getting myself better. I started, because people were talking about mental health more, and I got the ADHD and the reading and writing, I got it all under control after a terrible time and I hit rock bottom. But I got it back on track, and then I met Brian. And the rest is history. Just don't know. We just clicked, and he just come into my life at the right time, and we're just a good. We're a strong couple. We help each other, and we've got trucks in Bristol, and I just enjoy life now, and I enjoy it for what it is, and just thank God for every day, because you know there's a lot of us don't make it, and it's such a hard sport that. It's just good to come through it and see it for what it really is.
Yeah. It's nice to hear though, Jane, you're in a good place now.
I'm in a great place.
Doing this book as well.
And I'm buzzing about the book as well, because like...
Tell us about that now. Did it come about that you
I'll tell
decided you wanted to do it?
Well, I'll tell you how it come about, because I've been friends with Ricky and Paul forever. And then, I don't know, I think Ricky was doing a show somewhere and I went and Paul was there. And Paul said, listen, just have a word with this publisher. And I'm like, no. I don't want to do it. I don't want to go back into that world. I hate it. I've got out of it. I got rid of all the idiots out of my life. I've gone, and I'm happy with Brian. And he's going, Jane, I know you are, but just come out, do the book, and then you can can it all again and go back to Brian. And I was like, right, fine. Can I do that? And he's like, yeah, you can do all your interviews, your publicity. And he helped me in another way, Paul. He told me, you've got to talk about it. Because if you talk about it, it helps. It helps massively. And I didn't think it would. Then I was luckily enough, he got me a ghostwriter called Abby Smith, who, total opposite to me, middle class, lives in London, couple of kids, very well to do. We just hit it off, she's brilliant. And by talking to her, and it was little bits over a month, and then maybe the next month I'd do a few more, and it came together. And when I read it all in one piece, I was like, do you know what? That's a really good story. I did change history, of course I did. And it was covered up. That I changed history. They still try and cover it up now, and try and not give you that credit. I don't want any credit. I don't want nothing off the boxing world. I don't shove it. I don't want anything. I did it. I know what I did, and I know that I changed things for the better. But it's down to this generation now to change it again, because there's a long way to go, a real long way.
Was it a good therapy for you doing the book?
Brilliant. It's the best thing I ever did. The best thing ever did. But you've got to tell it. Yeah, you revisit it, but also you've got to remember when I did the book, like I was better. I was thinking clear, I wasn't drinking and I wasn't making a dick of myself and I'm happy. Do you know what I mean? And it makes a difference doing it then, because when you're doing most boxing books, they're not really the truth anyway. You know? They're not. The authors of them will tell you the same. But when you when you could just be honest with people, and I'm turning into my mum. I've just told, I can just tell anybody what I think now, it's great to be able to do it, because they can't say, oh, you were this, that. I've already said what I was. Yes, I did have mental health problems. I was going through boxing with mental health problems. Maybe I shouldn't have even been boxing in some of them fights, but I didn't have anyone to tell me that. Nobody. It was only when, like I say, Frank Bruno and Ricky, and I was listening to them, and I was thinking, wow, that's what's wrong with me. Like, I need to get some help. And it was, when you get the help and you see things more clearer, and you don't care what people think. Like, I don't care for anyone. I don't care what anybody thinks. I really don't, but I still love boxing. It's weird. It's weird.
But you still watch it?
I love the big fights. Yeah, I don't really, not so much on the undercard ones and that, but the big fights and the girls and, you know, it's good to stay in touch. But again, I only stay in touch with the nice people in boxing, because I know who the nice people are now. I didn't back then. I just thought everyone was my friend, and they weren't.
What's the highlight of your career, Jane? You know, is the highlight of your career, you know, in the ring or out of the ring?
I think it's a real hard one, because that case was was so intense. You know, that was 2 years in the making, that case. And it was digging up everything and proving that it was no more danger for a woman to do it. But also to meet the people that I met while doing the case, like Diana Rose, the best sex discrimination lawyer in the country. But I'm not really sure, but I probably would say the first world title fight in Denmark against Sandra Geiger. She was like fierce and knocked everybody out and had four fights, and it was an up and down. It was a hell of a hard fight for me, but to come from nothing after four fights and beat someone of that caliber, and I just think, wow, yeah. And then I couldn't stop reliving that night after I won it, but then maybe that was the problem. I just kept reliving that, and it makes you carry on. What, and you think the next one's going to be the same? But I don't know. I'd probably say the first world title fight in Denmark, and there were some British lads on the undercard. We had such a crack as well, and we all went for our meal vouchers, and I didn't have a penny on me, and they gave them all the meal vouchers, and I went for mine. And said, "Oh, you can't have them. It's for the fighters." I went, "Yeah, I'm fighting." He said, "Yeah, but you're a woman." I said, "I'm still hungry." Well. Sorry, you're not having it. So I never got any meal vouchers. And I'm trying to think of the name. Wally Dixon was there with one of his fighters. And we just had the best. And no one gave me a chance. Oh, I love Wally, yeah, great. And we just had the best, like, few days there. And then when I won the fight, we all got steaming after me. And I made some real good friends and met some real nice people, because, again, they were all on the undercard, so they weren't meant to win anyway. So they, and for me to win it, it was just, I don't know. I'll never, ever forget that, them few days, as long as I live. But I'll never forget the court case, but for the wrong reasons with the court case, because they was just so horrible to me. They just, like, why did they abuse me that bad? Why? What did I do so wrong? And that was like, that was horrendous. Like, that was an horrendous time. But at the end of it, when she came, they wanted to settle out of the court, the board, and she came in the back, she said, "They want to settle out of court." And my barrister went, "We're having our day in court." And it was a great day in court, because it showed how pathetic and how nasty and how vile than people on the board were.
Can we just have Jane for a minute to film?
Yeah, of course.
Come on, we gotta go.
Right, Jane, we've been here for ages.
Yeah, we've been here for ages. So he's got everything he wants, and now we're gonna go and film with Stacey.
It's great to see you, Jane.
I lovely to see you, Chris.
All the best with you.
I really mean it. You're doing a great job, and your site is right up there. It's brilliant.
Cheers, Jane. See you soon.
See you soon, love.
Sorry, I'm gonna lose my crew otherwise. That's the problem. Sorry.